Item number, SCP-272, object class, safe. Special containment procedures. SCP-272 is to be contained in a small wooden box in a vault at Sector 25. Apart from this, no further containment is necessary, as the object is completely inert when not in use. Care is to be taken not to drop the item during transit. Description. SCP-272 is an iron nail, approximately 11.5 centimeters long, resembling ancient designs. Covering every flat surface are engravings of unknown cultural origin. The engravings have been described as captivating, but scary, in a majority of staff interviewed. The nature of the object becomes apparent when it is dropped onto the shadow of an individual. The nail will bury itself exactly two-thirds of its length into the material the shadow is cast on. Following this, two effects should be noted. The person whom the shadow belongs to will not be able to remove the nail by any means, and they are limited to movements that keep their shadow cast on the nail. The nail, however, may be removed by conventional means by anyone else, although those requested to do so reported a mild aversion, citing claims that, quote, it feels fair. The object was discovered during a routine sweep embedded into an exposed rock face near an abandoned Air Force base in Afghanistan, with a human skeleton scattered around it. It was thought to be mundane, until a researcher dropped it at their feet, and was subsequently pinned to the spot for 20 minutes before being assisted. Experiment Log 272A. Test Subject 1D Class Personnel D-2721. Surface. Rock face at discovery site. Lighting. Midday sun, directly overhead. Purpose. Establish nature of SCP. Procedure. Subject was handed the nail and told to hammer it into his shadow at his feet. Results. Subject complies. Once the nail had reached the two-third mark, subject could not continue. Subject attempts to move away, but is unable to. Subject soon becomes fatigued and succumbs to heat stroke. Object removed. Subject given medical treatment. Conclusions. Nature of the object established. 272B. Test subject. 1D class personnel. D-2722. Surface. As above. Lighting. Night. Minimal. Purpose. Establish effects at night. Procedure. Nail was dropped at subject's feet and embedded itself exactly two-thirds of the way in. Subject then asked to move 10 meters away from the nail. Results. Object embeds. Subject complies, showing no adverse effects. Subject then attempts to escape and is terminated. Object recovered. Conclusions. Subject is free to move when no shadow is cast. 272C. Test Subject. 1D Class Personnel. D-2723. Surface. As above. Lighting. As above. 2 hours before sunrise. Purpose. Establish effects of lighting changes. Procedure. Nail dropped as above. Subject told to walk in a straight line away from the nail. Results. Object embeds. Subject shows no adverse effects. Sunrise occurs at 6:06 local time. Subject is data expunged. 3 cleanup teams dispatched. Subject's torso recovered 106 meters from object, showing signs of road rash and severe blunt trauma. Object recovered. Testing moved to Sector 25. Conclusions. Data expunged. 272D. Test Subject. 1D Class Personnel. D-2724. Surface. Concrete floor of Test Facility 25H. Lighting. 1 standard 60-watt light bulb, directly overhead. Purpose. Establish lighting requirements. Procedure. Nail dropped on the shadow of Test Subject. Subject told to walk in a straight line away from the object. Results. Object embeds. Subject is free to move. Object recovered. Conclusions. Insufficient lighting will cause no effect. 272E. Test subject. 1 D-class personnel. D-2724. Surface. As above. Lighting. 1 standard 1500 watts stadium light. Directly overhead. Purpose. As above. Procedure. As above. Results. Object embeds. Subject trapped. Object recovered. Conclusions. Lighting requirements established. 272F. Test subject. 2 D-class. D-2724 and D-2725. Surface. As above. Lighting. 2 stadium lights. Position 90 degrees apart. Purpose. Determine if multiple subjects can be held. Procedure. Subjects positioned so their shadows overlap. Object dropped onto both shadows. Subjects told to advance away from the nail. Results. Object embeds. Subject D-2724 continues unhindered, but reports feeling a chill. D-2725 is held by the object. Object recovered. Conclusions. Object cannot hold more than one subject. Potential secondary effect observed. 272G. Test subject. 8 D-class. D-2724 through D-2711. Surface. As above. Lighting. 4 stadium lights. Positioned in a ring around the subjects. Purpose. Determine the selection mechanism for which subject is held. Procedure. Subjects positioned so their shadows overlap. Nail dropped onto all 8 shadows. Results. Object embeds. Subject D-2729 is held. 18 years of age. Caucasian. 1.8 meters. 88 kilograms. All others free to move. Reports of a scream from all subjects except D-2729. All subjects except D-2729 seem to shiver. Object recovered. D-2729 removed from study. Experiment repeated. Subject D-2726 held. 24 years of age. Hispanic. 1.6 meters. 102 kilograms. All others appear to shiver and report a scream, but remain free. Experiment repeated 4 additional times as per the above method. Discontinued after D-2727 fell unconscious. Subject given treatment for severe hypothermia. Conclusions. Emerging patterns suggest that the youngest possible subject to be held will be. Additionally, secondary effect on larger groups observed. Further research pending acquisition of a larger sample group. Addendum. Subjects of equal gender distribution. Ages ranging from 18 to 59. Numerous physical traits represented. 272H. Test subject. 1 D-class. D-2725. Surface. 1 outdoor field. Grassy. Lighting. Early morning sun. Approximately 9 a.m. Purpose. To determine if subject can escape by digging. Procedure. Object dropped onto subject's shadow. Subject then given a shovel and told to dig out the object. Results. Subject digs for 90 seconds, then falls over screaming. Subject expires before medical intervention could be administered. Autopsy reveals subject died of a cerebral hemorrhage. Cause indeterminate. Object recovered. Field repaired. Repeated with D-2727 and 8. Results identical. Conclusions. Subjects held by SCP-272 cannot dig the nail out. Attempting to do so is invariably fatal. 272I. Test subject. None. Surface. NA. Lighting. NA. Purpose. To determine the object's destructibility. Procedure. 1 D-class personnel. D-2729. Is given the object and a selection of tools and told to go to town in an attempt to destroy the object. Test area evacuated. Results. Subject selected an angle grinder set the object in a vise, and proceeded to bring the grinder upon the object. An instant later, subject is seen writhing on the ground, clutching his temples. Audio recordings from inside the room record subject speaking in. 30 seconds later, subject expires. Autopsy reveals the cause to be a cerebral hemorrhage. Examination of the object reveals some minor damage from the grinder. Conclusions: object appears to be fully destructible, but will resist actions against it with lethal force by an unknown method. Object tested to maintain its original functionality. 272J. Test subject. 1 D-class personnel. D-27210. Surface. Concrete floor of test facility 25H. Lighting. 1 stadium light, positioned on a computer-controlled track. Purpose. A. Determine the effects of rapid lighting shifts. And B. Determine if subject can be withheld from the object via restraints, barriers, etc. Procedure. Test 1. Light positioned to cast a long shadow. Nail dropped into the head of the subject's shadow. Light slowly raised. Results. Test 1. Subject dragged at a proportional rate towards the object. Subject has difficulty standing. Procedure. Test 2. As above. Light raised very rapidly. Results. Test 2. As above, but at a more rapid rate. Noted that subject was unable to remain standing and accelerated upon falling. Attributed to the decrease in shadow size relative to standing. Subject acquired minor road rash. Procedure. Test 3. As above. Subject restrained with chains attached to their feet. Chicken wire screen placed between subject and object. Results. Test 3. Data expunged. Subject expires. Object recovered. Further testing with restrained subjects prohibited. Conclusions. Subjects seem to be dragged by their shadow at a rate required to keep it cast upon the object. Intervening obstacles appear not to impede this function, although will damage the subject, or in the case of barriers like the chicken wire. Data expunged. 272H. Test subject. 1 D-class personnel. D-2724. Surface. As above. Lighting. 1 stadium light in a fixed position, roughly 45 degrees from horizontal. Purpose. Establish the effects of long-term containment. Procedure. D-2724 positioned central to the room. Object is dropped onto the subject's shadow. Results. Subject held. After the third day, subject becomes unresponsive to attempts to provide nourishment. After the first week, subject heard to only speak. By the 11th day, the subject, having not eaten or drank in 8 days, seemed to become agitated, rapidly shifting between mania and a comatose state. At the 14-day mark, the test is terminated. Object recovered. Subject noted to be severely malnourished, but resumed speaking English once the object is removed and proceeded to recover rapidly before monthly termination. Conclusions. Extended containment has yielded that the subject will survive for prolonged periods without nourishment, but will enter a degraded mental state. Addendum. Partial transcript of subject D-2724's manic speaking from day 14. Translated sections and curly brackets. Begin transcript. Dr. Kimiro, for the record, state your name. D-2724. Ashes burn at my tongue, I cannot taste the water boils at my sight. Dr. Kimiro, can you repeat that? D-2724. I cannot sleep, the screams are heard, I am not the worm the shadow steals. Dr. Kimiro, right. How do you feel? D-2724. The chains they bind, I cannot move the people, data expunged. Dr. Kimiro, what is he saying? What is he speaking? Someone get me a translator. D-2724. Growing louder. Cut my flesh to ribbons that I might be free. Subject begins clawing at his skin. Data expunged. I am the prisoner of my own foolishness. Let the crows come and data expunged. Let my flesh crumble like the apple whose ashes burn at my tongue. End transcript. Item number, SCP-255. Object class, Keter. Special containment procedures. Tissue samples and specimens related to SCP-255 are contained at Biosite 16, a purpose-built containment and research facility designed to priority beta contagious phenomenon specifications. Biosite 16 is subject to a remote location personnel rotation waiver, in addition to standard contagious phenomenon preventative quarantine periods. Biosite 16 is located in the Vaitupu Atoll of Tuvalu, on an island owned by Ragnarok Ecological Modeling Incorporated, a Foundation front organization. Persons and animals determined to be infected with SCP-255 are to be secured and transported to a designated temporary holding facility prior to transfer to Biosite 16. In cases where capture of an SCP-255 carrier is exceedingly difficult or impossible, lethal force is authorized. The Office of Celestial Anomalies is to continually track the orbit of 3214 Hybris, maintain a schedule of upcoming near-Earth flybys, and alert the research director if any changes in observed orbit occur. The next scheduled flyby of 3214 Hybris is the 11th of November 2023, when it is predicted to pass within 950,000 kilometers of Earth. Description: SCP-255 is an anomalous infectious phenomenon of extraterrestrial origin, manifesting in most living subjects as a neurological disorder with varying symptoms. Eligible carriers of SCP-255 have thus far been observed to be organisms possessing a cerebral cortex with approximately greater than or equal to 5.4 billion neurons. Experimentation has determined that species capable of contracting SCP-255 include humans, chimpanzees, African elephants, bottlenose dolphins, false killer whales, and others. In non-human carriers, SCP-255 causes, through unknown means, degeneration of motor neurons and nerve cells. The rate of degeneration and severity of related symptoms is inversely related to the number of neurons the subject possesses in its cerebral cortex, with less neurologically developed organisms displaying the most debilitating effects. The effects of SCP-255 on humans, however, is markedly more complex. While degradation of brain cells in the nervous system has been noted on a limited basis in humans, a range of more unusual symptoms occur in these subjects. Individuals infected by SCP-255 can be reliably diagnosed through EEG observation and confirmation of verified markers and measurements of neurological activity. Outbreaks of SCP-255 coincide with close flybys of 3214 Hybris, a relationship that was theorized using advanced statistical models following the second outbreak in 1965, and confirmed during the asteroid's 1987 close approach. Observations of 3214 Hybris have determined it to be an approximately 110-meter C-type asteroid, with no anomalous properties observed at this time. The nature of the orbit of 3214 Hybris brings it into close approach with Earth once every 11 years. Addendum 2551, Research Log. The following is a listing of known SCP-255 outbreaks and relevant data. Estimated date of outbreak, 23rd of May, 1968. Location, Sagaing, Myanmar. Number of confirmed human cases, 86. Incidence rate, not available. The first known outbreak of SCP-255 occurred in 1968, known now to have coincided with 3214 Hybris passing within 350,000 kilometers of Earth. All known infected individuals resided within 7 kilometers of the township of Maulik. Foundation assets became aware of SCP-255 while investigating an unknown illness affecting certain primates, including humans, in rural regions of northwestern Myanmar. The number of animals affected is unknown, but was estimated at the time to be between 1,000 and 5,000 individuals, primarily among forest-dwelling monkey species. All human instances and a representative sample of infected monkeys were brought under Foundation control, and special containment procedures enacted. In controlled laboratory conditions, animal subjects displayed advanced signs of motor neuron impairment, with a 100% mortality rate over a period of 3 weeks. Human subjects displayed mild neurological impairment, comparable to that experienced after a minor stroke. Experimentation confirmed that the disorder was not contagious. All human subjects recovered within 10 days, and were released without incident after being informed that they were treated under a World Health Organization initiative. Estimated date of outbreak, 19th June, 1979. Locations: Acre, Brazil; Rhode Island, Indonesia; Croker Island, Australia. Number of confirmed human cases, 11. Incidence rate, not available. A second SCP-255 outbreak occurred in 1979 in three separate regions, undetected until 19 months later when a routine review of forthcoming medical literature documented several individuals complaining of a phantom limb sensation affecting the dominant hand, simulating the spastic movement and persistent ache of an extraneous 11th digit. Foundation personnel covertly interviewed subjects claiming to be affected by this phenomenon. Subsequent research determined that all individuals resided within 25 kilometers of the 11th parallel south and were experiencing an anomalous condition. Lack of person-to-person transmission capabilities were confirmed, and disinformation measures in the scientific community were carried out, achieving effective containment. The second outbreak was classified as a separate SCP designation until 1984, when research determined it to be the same phenomenon as SCP-255. Estimated date of outbreak, 30th of May, 1990. Locations: Chihuahua, Mexico. Number of confirmed human cases, 121. Incidence rate, not available. The third documented outbreak of SCP-255 occurred in Chihuahua, Mexico in 1990, coinciding with the passage of 3214 Hybris within 550,000 kilometers of Earth. Characteristic of SCP-255, the outbreak is noted to have started in what was at the time the 11th most populous city in the 11th most populous country on Earth. Beginning in this instance and continuing through subsequent outbreaks, only human subjects have been infected by SCP-255. Affected subjects in this outbreak displayed altered circadian rhythms, sleeping for periods between 3 to 4 hours at a time, and awaking fully refreshed, conducting activities, and then tiring and sleeping within an average period of 7 hours, thus operating biologically in accordance with an 11-hour day. During interactions with researchers, test subjects displayed a tendency to change subjects in the middle of speaking to say hello in either English, Portuguese, or Indonesian, the languages spoken by infected subjects in the second outbreak. Subjects would state hello in one of these languages, regardless of any prior linguistic knowledge, and uniformly claimed no recollection of doing so. Additionally, these subjects would address Foundation personnel as members of the World Health Organization without prompting. In all other manners, test subjects observed in this iteration of SCP-255 functioned in their altered biorhythm in a normal manner, before recovering and returning to a normal, non-anomalous state within 2 to 3 weeks. Estimated date of outbreak, 11th of November, 2001. Locations: Quito, Ecuador. Number of confirmed human cases, 1,331. Incidence rate, 13.9%. The fourth outbreak of SCP-255 took place in an office building in the 12-day Octubre Avenue business district of Quito, Ecuador. At the time of the outbreak, Ecuador had a population of approximately 11 million people. Additionally, the building in which the initial outbreak was localized was 11 stories high. The fourth outbreak is the first observed instance of SCP-255 being transmitted from person to person, with an incidence rate in laboratory conditions of 13.9%. Infectious iterations of SCP-255 have since been observed to be transmitted from person to person by sustained close proximity, generally within a 2-meter radius, despite the lack of observable pathogens. This change in pathogenicity, along with the higher initial number of cases, was responsible for the reclassification of SCP-255 to Keter, effective the 23rd of December, 2001. Foundation operatives seized control of the building under the established World Health Organization cover. The size of the outbreak, however, mandated heightened secrecy protocols. Test subjects were transported to Biosite 16 for observation. Similar to the second outbreak, infected individuals reported experiencing a phantom limb-like sensation. However, in this event, the phenomenon was intensified greatly. Test subjects reported the sensation of 7 additional limbs, originating at seemingly random points of the body, with no apparent relation to existing anatomy. While the precise nature of the additional appendages was difficult to ascertain, infected persons reported that they felt as though they had 3 joints, were approximately a meter in length, and had no structure analogous to a hand or foot at the end. These limbs were apparently not subject to the painful contractions and sensations normally associated with amputees. However, subjects uniformly reported heightened distress at the sensation of 7 additional limbs, moving independently of their control at most times. Additionally, test subjects lost conscious control of their left arms. At most times, subjects were unable to move their left arms. However, at 1100 hours local time each day, the left arms and hands of infected individuals would independently make motions analogous to what appeared to be the act of writing. When supplied with pen and paper, these individuals all wrote, in crudely formed script, the numbers 11, 11, 65, theorized at the time to be the date of the next outbreak, and confirmed 11 years later. All infected individuals ceased to be affected by SCP-255 within 3 to 4 weeks. Test subjects were administered broad-spectrum amnestics and released to Ecuadorian authorities. Foundation assets within the World Health Organization disseminated disinformation related to an exotic strain of malaria and subsequent treatment efforts as part of containment efforts. Estimated date of outbreak, 11th of November, 2012. Locations, Brussels, Belgium. Number of confirmed human cases, 11. Incidence rate, 100%. The 5th and most recent outbreak of SCP-255 took place in Brussels, Belgium, where 11 individuals working on the 11th floor of the NATO headquarters building all complained to medical staff of constantly hearing a set of 11 electronic tones, repeating constantly. Containment protocols were activated by Western Europe sector personnel, and all infected subjects were transported to Biosite 16. Test subjects continued to complain of hearing the repetitive set of tones. Most subjects experienced heightened stress and irritability, as well as sleep deprivation. Infected individuals were administered sedatives to ameliorate secondary SCP-255 symptoms. Testing of this group of infected individuals revealed the incidence rate of SCP-255 was now 100%, ensuring that any humans exposed to the subjects would contract it. 11 days after the test subjects were secured at Biosite 16, infected individuals reported a cessation of the perceived repetitive tones. One test subject immediately reported hearing an electronic voice, similar to that generated by speech simulation software, repeating the Spanish word, Estrella. Once the subject reported the phenomenon to researchers, it immediately ceased, whereupon another of the original 11 test subjects reported a similar phenomenon. The original cluster of infected individuals appear to comprise a phrase in this manner, the constituent words of which were repeated in order for every new case of infection beyond this group. The phrase is transcribed below, translated from Spanish to English for this version of the document. Binary star lost not lost, transpose dead instruction urgent, await transmission. Upon relating to researchers this particular symptom, all test subjects ceased to display any signs of SCP-255 infection. Subjects were amnestized per SCP-255 guidelines and released. Item number, SCP-268. Object class, Euclid. Special containment procedures. SCP-268 is currently to be maintained within Data Expunged, as it has been deemed that the change of use for the facilitation of escape by restricted personnel or humanoid SCP is too great. However, the possibility of use by field agents after further testing is under review. Note: special containment procedures have been modified. See Addendum 268-05 for detailed information. Description: SCP-268 is a tweed wool newsboy cap. The design and make seem to be of Irish origin. Due to the style and fabric, it is estimated to have been created in the late 1800s to early 1900s, though fiber analysis is inconclusive. The only markings on the cap are a small label with writing in Middle Irish, reading, "The garden is the serpent's place." However, there are various indications that this label was sewn onto the cap in recent times. Due to the nature of the artifact, testing has been extremely difficult. SCP-268 seems to be a normal hat until it is worn. Anyone wearing the hat, however, suddenly and instantly becomes unnoticeable. Subjects become unmemorable, thoroughly ignorable, or taken for granted by all observers. Observers, with specific prompting, are able to later recall physically seeing the subject, but can give no specific details other than seeing a man with a hat. Observers seem to have the overwhelming feeling that the wearer is someone that was supposed to be there, and thus did not merit thought or notice. During initial testing, remote analysts completely forgot what they were supposed to be observing within the chamber, and it was not until the D-class subject wearing SCP-268 spoke out loud that he was noticed again. Removal of the artifact, vocalization, and physical interaction with observers seem to be the only way in which wearers of SCP-268 can make themselves noticeable. Once an observer has been made to notice an SCP-268 wearing individual, they slowly begin to ignore the subject once more, unless kept actively engaged by the wearer. Testing reveals that if a subject wears SCP-268 upward of 20 cumulative hours, its effects seem to linger, with diminished potency, on the subject even while not wearing the artifact. Testing in this area has been cautious due to the possibility of containment breaches, but one incident has shown that if the artifact is worn long enough, that the effect is rendered permanent and unbreakable. Extensive research is still unable to determine whether or not electronics are directly affected by SCP-268. Observers viewing an SCP-268 wearing subject through electronic means still have difficulty acknowledging the subject's existence, and even when noticed, observers report to be unable to see the face of the individual in question. Observers note pictures of SCP-268 wearing individuals as being blurry, and digital media such as surveillance cameras is reported to become grainy and unfocused. Research is unsure whether these alterations are extant and physical, or merely perceived due to SCP-268's properties. It should be noted that although capturing SCP-268 through visual electronic means has been difficult, motion sensing, weight sensing, heat seeking, and similar devices all trigger correctly when encountering an SCP-268 wearing subject. Addendum 268-01. SCP-268 is noted to have some similarities to SCP-180. SCP-268, however, does not seem to function on inanimate objects, and more importantly, does not directly steal the identity of its host. While SCP-180 causes its host to become unrecognizable after SCP-180 itself is removed and placed on another object, this seems to be a side effect of its function of identity theft and transfer. Meanwhile, SCP-268 could be said to steal the identity of longtime wearers, as they become irrevocably forgotten. This has caused some speculation as to whether the items share similar origins, or whether the many similarities they share are merely coincidental. Addendum 268-02. At Agent's request, and after approval by Dr. and Dr. Klein, SCP-268 is being used with agents in active field duty. Results thus far have been favorable. Addendum 268-03. Field testing has been suspended. Though Agent appears to have been on payroll and on records, no personnel, either on site or in higher command, remember knowing or hearing about an agent. Further tests should be conducted only on D-Class personnel, and on no single individual for longer than 10 hours. Addendum 268-04. SCP-268's effects seem to strengthen and become permanent as individual subjects wear the artifact for extended periods of cumulative time. There is a marked difference in the potency of SCP-268's effect on someone wearing it for the first time and someone who has worn the artifact upwards of 5 hours on other occasions. For example, someone who has not worn the cap before seems to dispel its effects merely by speaking. Those who have worn the artifact on several occasions for extended amounts of time seem to be able to ask observers questions and receive answers, with the observer having little to no recollection of the event. In one test, a subject who had worn the artifact for upwards of 15 hours was able to ask standing personnel the test chamber's password, nearly causing a containment breach and the escape of D-Class personnel. The security personnel in question reported being unable to recall parting with the information in question. Dr. Klein. Addendum 268-05. As of SCP-268 is missing. Its absence was discovered early in the morning by Agent and research analysts, and in its place was a note reading, "Thanks, I needed my hat back. L.S." A full investigation of this security breach has been launched. Item number, SCP-286. Object class, Euclid. Special containment procedures. SCP-286 is to be kept in a secure containment cell at Site 19 that allows an open, secure perimeter of at least 50-meter radius around SCP-286. Only D-Class personnel are permitted to have direct physical contact with SCP-286, and only as part of an approved experiment. Update 07-19-2000. Experiments with SCP-286 are hereby suspended until further notice. 05. Surveillance cameras are to be positioned to allow 360-degree monitoring of SCP-286 during experimentation. Recordings shall be maintained and catalogued of all Sigma states exhibited by SCP-286. Update 03-11-2000. As of Incident I-2865, surveillance of SCP-286 is to be continuous, and any initiation of a Sigma state is to be immediately reported to Overwatch Command. Outside the immediate Project Directorate, the SCP-286 Sigma state archives and associated material are to be restricted to Level 4 access. Under no circumstances are identified instances of SCP-286-1 or SCP-286-2 to be prevented from having contact with SCP-286. 05. Description. SCP-286 is a carved stone game board, measuring 83 centimeters on a side. It bears markings consistent with the Chinese game of Lu Bo. Based on artifacts found with SCP-286 during recovery, SCP-286 has been dated to at least the Shang Dynasty, though all attempts to date the carvings directly have been inconclusive. Analysis of SCP-286's composition has shown high concentrations of iron and nickel, and crystalline microstructures consistent with. If any higher-order mammal touches SCP-286, it will initiate a Sigma state. A Sigma state is indicated by the appearance of 12 tokens on the surface of the game board. The tokens appear to be constructed of the same material as SCP-286. 6 tokens are dark, absorbing 75% more ambient light than the board's surface, while 6 tokens are light, emitting 75% more ambient light than that which actually strikes them. Appearing with the tokens on the game surface are 2 18-sided dice, apparently made of bronze. As with the game tokens, a direct physical examination of the dice has proved to be impossible. The dice share the anomalous reflective and absorption properties shown by the game tokens, one light and one dark. Otherwise, the dice appear consistent with dice found in non-anomalous Lu Bo sets recovered from various Chinese archaeological sites. A Sigma state will also manifest SCP-286-1 and SCP-286-2 to play a game. SCP-2861 and SCP-2862 are higher-order mammals who have suffered temporary alterations in patterns of movement, cognition, behavior, and vocalization. SCP-2861 will appear agitated, movements will become jerky and imprecise, vocalizations will be quick, stuttering, and aggressive. SCP-2862 will appear sluggish, movements halting and slow. Vocalizations will be low-pitched, throaty, and tend to be monosyllabic. Subjects capable of human speech will converse, but only to their opposite number during a Sigma event. Such conversations, or monologues in the case of a subject facing a non-human opponent, are conducted in a random sequence of human languages, sometimes shifting multiple times within a single statement. Only 45% of the recorded conversations between SCP-2861 and SCP-2862 have been successfully translated to date. The subject who initiated the Sigma state will become an instance of SCP-2861 if they touched SCP-286 on an illuminated surface, or they will become an instance of SCP-2862 if they touched SCP-286 on a surface that is in shadow. In either case, the subject will take a seated position to one side of the board. Instances of SCP-2861 will take a position on the side nearest the light game tokens. Instances of SCP-2862 will take a position on the opposing side, nearest the dark game tokens, and roll one of the two dice manifested by SCP-286. After the die is rolled, some other higher-order mammal will appear within 47 meters of SCP-286 and become the subject's opposition. SCP-2862 in the case where the subject is SCP-2861, or SCP-2861 the case where the subject is SCP-2862. This selection appears related to the result of the first die roll. After appearing, the subject's opposition will take a seated position facing the subject and will commence playing the first move. Gameplay then consists of SCP-2861 and SCP-2862 alternately rolling dice and moving pieces on the board in complex patterns. A game is won when the center square contains all of one side's tokens, and only that side's tokens. A winning move concludes a Sigma state. During a Sigma state, SCP-2861 and SCP-2862 will show no reaction to any external stimuli that does not physically interfere with SCP-2861, SCP-2862, and their interaction with the game. If something disrupts an ongoing game, then either SCP-2861 or SCP-2862 will stand and vocalize a statement that most commonly translates as forfeit, less commonly as draw. This event will also conclude a Sigma state. When a Sigma state concludes, players cease being designated SCP-2861 or SCP-2862, and game tokens, dice, and the subject's opposing player all vanish. All observed subjects, and those opposing players who have been identified and examined, have shown no physical after-effects from interaction with SCP-286. However, all cases have shown a marked increase in spirituality and interest in religious subjects, including, but not limited to, adoption of new belief systems, taking on of vows, speaking in tongues, and prophetic visions. For the winning player, this new spirituality will tend to take an optimistic, messianic character. For the losing player, attitudes will tend toward the apocalyptic. Addendum 1. Technical Note, TN-286-55. SCP-286's possible relationship to divination and or revelation. Historically, Lubo was not only a game, but also used as a method of divination. The various spots on the game board corresponding to the sexagenary cycle used by Chinese to recount the passage of time since the earliest written texts. Given the propensity of subjects to have prophetic visions subsequent to their participation in a Sigma event, it has been theorized by several researchers that the moves during a Sigma event may themselves be of some prophetic significance. While the possible significance of individual moves during recorded Sigma events is ongoing and so far inconclusive, it has been determined that the act of winning does appear to correspond to significant events beyond the game itself. In particular, Every instance of SCP-2861 winning has been tied to intensification of sunspots, solar flares, and generally increased solar activity. SCP-2862 winning has been associated with significant tectonic events, including... Because it is not known if these events were predicted by one side winning, or caused by one side winning, experimentation on SCP-286 has been suspended as an unacceptable risk. Addendum 2. Document TR-28627E. Excerpted translation of dialogue between SCP-2861 and SCP-2862 during Sigma Event Number 27. Foreword. D-Class test subject was a male Caucasian, 44 years of age, identified as SCP-2861 after initiation of a Sigma state. Opposition player, SCP-2862, was an as-yet-unidentified Hispanic female, approximately 20 years of age. The Sigma state lasted for 68 minutes, at which time SCP-2861 achieved the winning move. During the Sigma event, the players conversed in 25 known languages and approximately 15 unknown languages. 30% of their dialogue was undecipherable or in an indeterminate language, marking this episode the most completely translated yet recorded. Begin transcript, 1300 hours, date undisclosed. SCP-2861. You move, rotate slowly, imprecisely, as untranslatable, matter, earth, universe. SCP-2862. Have, possess, patience, my hour, brother, and still quiet silence. Untranslatable, mind, thoughts, brain. SCP-2861. Untranslatable. SCP-2862. Laughs. Distress, discomfort, displeasure. Untranslatable, to you. SCP-2861. Why would I untranslatable? Your sins, perversions, abominations. SCP-2862 laughs. SCP-2861. You disgust me. Untranslatable. Matter, earth, universe. Disgusts me. SCP-2862. You untranslatable in that meat skin. This amuses me. SCP-2861. Untranslatable. SCP-2862. Move, process, sequence. SCP-2861. Every time, moment, eternity. My untranslatable, closer. I must, will, shall, illuminate, enlighten, this untranslatable. SCP-2862. Sighs. Move, process, sequence. SCP-2861. You are too comfortable, undisturbed, enslaved, bound, chained, with an untranslatable meat doll puppet. Do you untranslatable love arousal? Untranslatable. SCP-2862. Move, process, sequence, or forfeit. SCP-2861. Untranslatable. SCP-2862. Untranslatable. Exiled, banished. Me to matter, earth, universe. Untranslatable. No, understand. Me more than you. SCP-2861. Untranslatable. Will know, understand me, and be consumed, engulfed, destroyed by knowledge, understanding. SCP-2862. But, brother, I am so much closer. End transcript, 1312, date undisclosed. Addendum 3. Incident report, I-2865. SCPs involved. SCP-286. SCP-2861. SCP-2862. SCP-4351. Date, 3-11-2000. Location, SCP-286's containment area, Site 19. Description, at 5:31 UTC, standard security monitoring SCP-286's containment area detected the unauthorized presence of Dr. S.S., a Foundation researcher temporarily assigned to Site 19, most recently assigned to the study of SCP-435. All experimentation on SCP-286 had been suspended for the preceding 8 months, and no activity with the object had been approved. A security team was dispatched, reaching Dr. S as she entered SCP-286's containment area. Upon arrival, the security team discovered the presence of Dr. L.W., a researcher assigned to SCP-286, already seated behind the dark side of SCP-286. SCP-286 showed the signs of already being in a sigma state. Both researchers showed behavioral anomalies, consistent with SCP-286-1 and SCP-286-2. Believing an unauthorized experiment was underway, the security team restrained Dr. S before she could seat herself at SCP-286. In response, Dr. L stood and vocalized what has been identified as Vulgate Latin words for grand forfeit. The Sigma State concluded at 5:45 UTC. Neither researcher could provide any explanation of how they were affected by SCP-286. Dr. S's last recollection was having a cup of coffee at a staff commissary on the other side of the Site 19 complex from SCP-286, while Dr. L reported that he had been reading emails in his office when he blacked out. Simultaneously, with the cessation of SCP-286's Sigma State, there was a sudden emergency in when SCP-4351 unexpectedly entered an active state, moving erratically and data expunged, impacting the ocean basin, causing a data expunged. Contingency 435XK Alpha had been initiated, but she was cancelled when SCP-4351 came to rest 3 minutes later. Note: SCP-286 classification is hereby upgraded to Euclid. 05. Item number: SCP-288. Object class: Safe. Special containment procedures: SCP-288 is to be kept in a locker, with only security personnel of level 2 clearance or higher given the combination. They are currently contained in the small velvet-lined black box they were retrieved in. Personnel who have worn the rings during testing are to undergo full psychological exams afterward, and their experience is recorded. Description: SCP-288 consists of a woman's engagement ring, hereafter referred to as SCP-2881, and matching men's band, hereafter referred to as SCP-2882, both silver in appearance, the ring containing a small diamond. They are relatively plain, and bear no marks as to their origin or make, but staff routinely describe them as seeming like very nice wedding rings, if a little plain. They are completely normal in every sense, and have been damaged by endurance testing, and subsequently repaired through typical jeweling practices, and their effects are only observable while worn. When SCP-2881 is worn by any adult female in a relationship, she immediately becomes what has been portrayed in popular media as an ideal housewife. Women describe this experience as if they are not in control of their body, merely observing their own actions. They lose all ability to form their own opinions, and instead automatically agree with the opinions of their spouse, and display very few negative emotions, if any. They seem to gain an instinctive knowledge of cooking and baking, in the style considered to be the, quote, traditional American style, including such dishes as apple pie or macaroni and cheese. These dishes are always professionally made, regardless of prior skill. A similar knowledge is evidenced in the spheres of cleaning and light repair. Subjects regularly display the ability to sew and knit, even if they were not able to do so before donning SCP-2881. Along with this knowledge, they feel an innate urge to cook, clean, and mend things around their home incessantly. They lose the will to have a job of their own, and become exceedingly obedient and loyal to their spouse, as well as religious and authority figures. Many wearers of SCP-2881 exhibit a fondness for rather modest dress, and are uncomfortable when wearing pants or more revealing clothing. They also develop a fondness for children, and if they do not already have children, express the urge to have them. When SCP-2882 is worn by any adult male in a relationship, he undergoes a similar change, taking on the characteristics of popular media's portrayal of an all-American dad, whether or not he has children of his own. Men describe the experience similarly to women, in that they feel they are not in control of their actions. He shows loyalty and obedience to political, religious, and authority figures, and an innate duty to his current professional management structure. He will work exceedingly long hours without complaint, and maintains an upbeat and motivated demeanor at his work. No matter the nature of his former personality, he becomes friendly and easy to approach, good with kids, and fiercely loyal to his spouse. He is always willing to help around the house, and willing to please with a shoulder rub. Men with children become attentive, engaged fathers, and men without children express a strong desire to have them. When used collectively, SCP-288 seems to recreate a model of a Stepford marriage. While this seems ideal and relatively harmless, SCP-288 has been responsible for numerous crimes, including spousal abuse, murder, and suicide. Both women and men report feeling trapped while wearing SCP-288 and out of control of their own life. After extended periods of wearing SCP-288, they often have intense feelings of depression and personality displacement. On a more sinister note, somebody wearing either instance of SCP-288 will take virtually any manner of abuse from a spouse without a word or raising a hand to defend themselves. In transsexual or transgender individuals, the ring appears to react to their gender identity. Therefore, a transsexual or transgender individual assigned male at birth would react to the female ring rather than the male ring, whether or not they were pre- or post-gender reassignment surgery. Homosexual subjects are affected by their actual gender. A male homosexual will not react to the female ring, just as a female homosexual will not react to the male ring. More testing upon sex and gender is pending. The potential for SCP-288 to create a domestic slave proves disturbing to some, and seems useful to others, and records show that it has been used in such a fashion before. Preliminary testing of SCP-288 has proved inconclusive. The rings themselves display no physical anomalies compared to a normal wedding ring of similar type. It is theorized that the rings profile their subjects mimetically, drawing on the experiences present in the subject to influence their behavior upon activation. This theory is supported by SCP-288's ability to differentiate subjects based on their self-perception of gender rather than their physical sex. SCP-288 was discovered by Dr. Wrights and data expunged. Thankfully, her boyfriend grew wary of her extreme mood changes and called the emergency SCP contact number she had left for him, delivering SCP-288 into the Foundation's hands. I'm just glad I got suckered into it before somebody else did, even if it was horrible. Dr. Wrights. It should be noted that both instances of SCP-288 resist being separated, and wearers may feel compelled to buy or even steal the rings in order to keep them nearby. Addendum 288A. It has been revealed through extensive backtracking of SCP-288's history that it has been associated with upwards of 25 instances of homicide, between 13 and 15 suicides, and 2 reported cases of spousal abuse. It has regularly resurfaced in pawn shops across the United States for at least 80 years, though all attempts to track it past the early 20th century have failed to reveal further evidence. Item number, SCP-258. Object class, safe. Special containment procedures. SCP-258 is to be kept in a standard storage vault with a keycard lock to be accessed only on approval from the supervisor of Site 15. SCP-258 is to be stored in a 2-meter by 2-meter basin, which is to be emptied twice a week by approved D-class personnel. All personnel interacting with SCP-258 are to be rotated no less than twice a month. While using SCP-258 is not directly harmful in any way, all who have utilized it have expressed a desire to do so again, ranging from the wistful to the vehement. All personnel interacting with SCP-258 are to be screened for underlying mental instability. After Incident 258-1, cleaning personnel are to be issued light hazmat suits while interacting with SCP-258. Description. SCP-258 was recovered from Maine after parents of local school children reported that stories of a sad, bouncy frog their children had been spreading were true. Agent F confirmed the nature of the object, and Foundation personnel replaced it with a replica without incident. SCP-258 appears to be a simple bouncing playground rider, seemingly designed to fit children of elementary school age, and shaped like a stylized green frog with rotating handles on either side of its head. SCP-258 has milky white eyes with what appear to be streams of white paint running down its face, as though it were weeping. Numerous attempts have been made to remove this substance from SCP-258. The green paint comes off with normal paint removal techniques, but the white substance, hereafter designated SCP-258-1, cannot. It only fades with time, observed to depend on various factors, including length of time utilized, and the extent of the emotional burden relieved. SCP-258 constantly appears to weep streams of SCP-258-1 at a constant rate of approximately 0.12 liters per hour. When a subject sits on SCP-258, grasps its handles, and begins rocking back and forth, they report that a feeling of peace and contentment washes over them. The eyes of the object then begin leaking SCP-258-1 at an accelerated rate, relative to the effect it has on its user's state of mind. Though this substance cannot be removed from SCP-258 once the seat is vacated, it remains in liquid form during use, and will drip from the object onto the ground. Testing of this material afterward has determined it to be a mixture of plain white paint, human tears, and skin secretions of the American bullfrog. How SCP-258 generates SCP-258-1 is unknown. The direct effect of SCP-258 only lasts for as long as the subject remains seated, though several subjects suffering symptoms of chronic depression have reported a lasting positive effect, resulting from some insight they gained while riding SCP-258. Repeated use of SCP-258 by a subject has shown to be mildly addictive, and Agent W had to be restrained and struck before regaining self-control. The results of allowing mentally unstable subjects access to SCP-258 is unknown, pending further testing, though it is likely that any subject suffering from severe depressive symptoms would cause SCP-258 to produce uncontrollable amounts of SCP-258-1. Addendum 258-1. After D-3354 committed suicide following repeated skin contact with SCP-258-1, the direct effects of contact with the substance were re-examined. Continuous skin contact with the fluid appears to transfer some of the emotions suppressed during use of the SCP, and the prior user was re-evaluated, revealing she was recovering from data expunged. Item Number SCP-252. Object Class Safe. Special Containment Procedures. SCP-252 is to be contained in a 150 cubic meter aquarium, reinforced with high tensile steel plating. Guards are to be specially trained in waterborne combat techniques, and armed with Model B-74H harpoon rifles, with high-capacity electrical discharge shafts. The tank is fitted with 15 remotely activated depth charges, which are to be detonated simultaneously if a containment breach is imminent. A breeding pair is maintained under the direction of marine biologist Dr. Personnel should not approach the containment tank unless they have been previously prepared for the anomalous effects of the animals. Additional specimens of SCP-252 may exist in the wild. Current specimens are considered sufficient, and further acquisitions are not a priority. Containment of information regarding encounters will consist of Standard Cover Story 53, Drunken Sailor, and administration of amnestics as necessary. Description: SCP-252 is a subspecies of Docidicus gigas. Mature specimens are noticeably smaller than average, reaching no more than 1 meter in length, and weighing a maximum of 40 kilograms. Dissection shows the absence of an ink sac and an increased density of chromatophores, approximately 20 times the normal adult average. Behavior is identical in most ways to mundane specimens, except when hunting or threatened. When a member of SCP-252 detects prey, they exhibit aggressive behavior and move towards the target at maximum speed while rapidly cycling their chromatophores. This color shifting has a hypnotic effect on prey animals that make visual contact, causing them to cease all defensive behavior and attempts to flee until grappled. When threatened by a predator or otherwise agitated, SCP-252 rapidly metamorphs into an unidentified aquatic life form of extreme size, with an indeterminate physiology and extremely destructive demeanor. Physical attributes in this state are in a constant state of change. Size fluctuates between 50 and 75 meters in length, with no fewer than 50, and occasionally as many as 200 appendages of various natures. Appendages shift constantly between suckered tentacles averaging 5 meters in length, insectoid limbs terminating in barbed pincers, and humanoid arms and legs ending in sharpened talons. Details and positions of appendages on the body also vary randomly, with the only constant being a cluster of tentacles around the head, obscuring the mouth area. It is not currently known how this rapid growth is achieved, due to the potential for a containment breach. No research on the matter is currently authorized. All animal life, excluding other SCP-252 and mundane squid species, will attempt to escape the vicinity by the most direct route possible. This fear response can cause the targets to harm themselves as they flee into hazardous conditions or ram repeatedly into container walls. Roughly 95% of subjects encountering an enraged SCP-252 develop a phobia of cephalopods. It is not known if this is an additional anomalous effect or a normal behavioral reaction to traumatic experiences. Upon review of security footage during containment, Dr. has determined that SCP-252's metamorphosis is in fact an advanced hallucination induced by the shifting pattern of chromatophores. These hallucinations cause the victim to see SCP-252 as a titanic sea creature with an excessively large number of tentacles. Specific details vary greatly from subject to subject, but the hallucinatory creature consistently presents as a greatly exaggerated cephalopod, with tentacles clustered around the mouth area, additional appendages with talons or pincers, and the general impression that all features are fluid and randomly shifting. Subjects removed from visual contact with SCP-252 will remain convinced that their hallucinations were a real sea monster and will attempt to rationalize any logical contradictions inherent in their delusion, such as a 100-meter monster swimming in a 10-meter enclosed tank. This rationalization and the lingering phobia is thought to be a form of post-hypnotic suggestion. Subjects viewing video of agitated SCP-252 who have never been exposed directly experience a much less severe fear reaction and are able to perceive the squid despite the hallucinations. Subjects describe the illusory monster as fake-looking and nonsensical, but still find it moderately frightening. After secondhand exposure, subjects develop a partial immunity to the full effects of direct exposure. Repeated direct contact after inoculation by video further lessens the effects. Acclimatized subjects can develop a complete immunity to the fear effect and experience only the vaguest awareness of the hallucinations. Addendum. SCP-252 came to Foundation attention after numerous reports of sea monster sightings by commercial fishermen off the coast of Agent secured a specimen at greater than usual personal danger. Commendation for performance above and beyond the call of duty recommended. Said agent allowed himself to be exposed to SCP-252's effects during first contact. Initial containment procedures were based on his reports of the specimen's size and physical capabilities, resulting in an excessive expenditure of resources. Disciplinary action recommended, pending oversight review. Item number, SCP-292. Object class, Euclid. Special containment procedures. SCP-292 is to be kept at Site 72, in a guarded room in a locked padded container, set up to avoid movement of or damage to SCP-292. Access to SCP-292 is prohibited without Level 3 authorization. Site personnel must report all incidents of déjà vu or related symptoms to site administration. Description: SCP-292 is a 60-second brass hourglass, 10 centimeters tall. When all its sand is at the bottom and SCP-292 is flipped over, only two outcomes have ever been observed. Either the sand runs out normally after 1 minute, or SCP-292 is knocked over on its side. If SCP-292 is knocked over, anomalous properties do not again manifest until all the sand in SCP-292 is in one bulb. At no time has SCP-292 ever been observed to be flipped over a second time within 60 seconds, except when knocked over as above. Anytime SCP-292 is upright and all its sand is in its bottom bulb, and a subject attempts to flip SCP-292 over, with the intent to flip it again before all its sand runs out, the subject and people nearby suddenly experience déjà vu. The intensity of déjà vu is inversely proportional to a person's distance from SCP-292. The subject is often momentarily stunned by the experience. Persons experiencing déjà vu from the same event often describe similar recalled experiences. It is believed that when SCP-292 is flipped over, a process is started in which, if SCP-292 is flipped again before its sands run out, time flows in reverse to a point a couple of seconds before SCP-292 was initially flipped. Time then flows forward again as if SCP-292 were never flipped. Déjà vu would thus be a side effect of this process. Prolonged exposure to SCP-292 can cause nausea, migraines, vertigo, hallucinations, seizures, and symptoms consistent with temporal disjunction, somatic, psychological, or both. Addendum 1. Experiment 292-31. Procedure: Subject 03101 was instructed to flip SCP-292 over, and then shoot Subject 03102 to death, and flip SCP-292 back over before it runs out. Results: As Subject 1 reached for SCP-292, both subjects, as well as other personnel in the area, reported feeling déjà vu. Subject 1 exhibited elevated levels of adrenaline, while Subject 2 exhibited pronounced apprehension in the presence of Subject 1. Addendum 2. Experiment 292-46. Procedure: Subject 04601 was instructed to flip SCP-292 over, wait 30 seconds, and flip SCP-292 back over. When déjà vu was experienced, Subject 04602 was instructed to do the same thing. When déjà vu was experienced a second time, Subject 04603 was instructed to do the same thing. Results: As Subject 1 reached for SCP-292, all subjects experienced déjà vu as expected. Subject 2 hesitated and was instructed to flip SCP-292. While reaching for SCP-292, Subject 2 fell to his knees, Subject 1 doubled over, and Subject 3 staggered. Subject 3 was instructed to flip SCP-292, and as he reached for SCP-292, all subjects appeared to exhibit temporal shock for 10 to 15 seconds before falling unconscious. Temporal symptoms subsided within 5 to 7 days, while visual and audio hallucinations persisted for several months more. Addendum 3. Incident 292-04. While preparing for experiment 292-75, Dr. suddenly clutched SCP-292 to his chest and reported he had just experienced déjà vu. Dr. said that he felt like he was about to drop SCP-292. And if he did, something bad would happen. Dr. has hypothesized that Dr. had indeed dropped SCP-292, but instead of breaking, SCP-292 reversed the flow of time until a moment before it was dropped. If SCP-292 does in fact possess such a self-preservation system, the potential consequences: data expunged, reclassification to Euclid approved until more information on SCP-292's properties can be gathered and analyzed. Item number: SCP-251. Object class: Euclid. Special containment procedures: SCP-251 is to be kept in a locked container at all times. No one is to enter the container alone. If anyone is found to have been left alone in the container for any amount of time, they are to be treated as violently hostile and terminated with extreme prejudice. The container is to be guarded by armed personnel at all times, and guards should never allow anyone, regardless of clearance level, to move the artifact or be alone with it. Sounds of screaming, gunfire, and fires will be heard from within the container. This is normal. Description: Origin unknown. SCP-251 consistently appears to be a small snow globe. Attached is a series of photographs taken of the same artifact over time. This indicates that the snow globe is at least partially animate. However, when viewed directly by multiple people, there is no apparent movement, except by a perpetual blizzard. SCP-251 has not been moved since its arrival at Site-19, but the snowflakes have never ceased falling. The scenes depicted in SCP-251 are all extremely violent or morbid, occasionally depicting something fantastical, while mostly depicting more realistic brutality. All those who have been alone with SCP-251 for any amount of time have later displayed extreme violence, xenophobia, and emotional distress. Lesson complete. To continue with your orientation training, subscribe to SCP Orientation right now, and make sure you don't miss any of our upcoming videos.